There's a famous seaside place called Blackpool that's noted for fresh air and fun. And Mr. and Mrs. Ramsbottom went there with young Albert, their son. He, a grand little lad, was young Albert, all dressed in his best, quite a swell, with a stick with an horse's head handle, the finest that Woolworths could sell. They didn't think much to the ocean, the waves, they was fiddling and small. There was no wrecks and nobody drowned. In fact, nowt to laugh at all. So seeking for further amusement, they paid and went into the zoo, where they'd lions and tigers and camels, aye, and old ale and sandwiches too. There were one great big lion called Wallace. His nose were all covered with scars. He lay in a somnolent posture, with the side of his face on the bars. Now Albert had heard about lions, how they was ferocious and wild. To see Wallace lying so peaceful, well, it didn't seem right to the child. So straightway the brave little fella, not showing a morsel of fear, took his stick with its horse's head handle and pushed it in Wallace's ear. You could see that Lion didn't like it, for giving a kind of a roll, he pulled Albert inside cage with him, aye, and swallowed the little lad whole. Then Pa, who had seen the occurrence and didn't know what to do next, said, "Mother, yon lion's at our Albert." And Mother said, "Ee, I am vexed." Then Mester and Mrs. Ramsbottom, quite rightly when all said and done, complained to the animal keeper that the lion had eaten their son. The keeper was quite nice about it. He said, "What a nasty mishap. Are you sure it's your boy is eaten?" Pa said, "Am I sure, Sithy, there's his cap." The manager had to be sent for. He came and said, "What's to do?" Pa said, "Yon lion's at our Albert, and him in his Sunday clothes too." Then Mother said, "Right's right, young fella. I think it's a shame and a sin for a lion to go and eat our Albert after we'd paid to come in." The manager wanted no trouble. He took out his purse right away, saying, "How much to settle this matter?" And Pa said, "Well, what do you usually pay?" But Mother had turned a bit awkward when she thought where our Albert had gone. She said, "No, no, someone's got to be summoned." So that was decided upon. Then off they went to police station in front of the magistrate chap. They told him what had happened to Albert and proved it by showing his cap. The magistrate gave his opinion that no one was really to blame, and he said that he hoped the Ramsbottoms would have further sons to their name. At that, Mother got proper blazing, and "Thank you, sir, kindly," said she. "What, waste all our lives raising children to feed your ruddy lions? Not me." Tower of London, large as life, the ghost of Anne Boleyn walks, they declare. Poor Anne Boleyn was once King Henry's wife, until he made the headsman bob her hair. Ah yes, he did her wrong long years ago, and she comes up at night to tell him so, with her head tucked underneath her arm. She walks the bloody tower with her head tucked underneath her arm. At the midnight hour. She comes to warn King Henry, she means giving him what for. Gadzook, she's going to tell him off for having spilt her gore. And just in case the headsman wants to give her an encore, she has her head tucked underneath her arm. Sometimes gay King Henry gives a spread for all his pals and gals, a ghostly crew. The headsman carves the joint and cuts the bread. Then in comes Anne Boleyn to queer the do. She holds her head up with a wild war whoop, and Henry cries, "Don't drop it in the soup." With her head tucked underneath her arm, she walks the bloody tower. With her head tucked underneath her arm, at the midnight hour, along the drafty corridors, for miles and miles she goes. She often catches cold, poor thing, it's cold there when it blows. And it's awfully awkward for the Queen to have to blow her doze with her head tucked underneath her arm. With her head tucked underneath her arm, she walks the bloody tower. With her head tucked underneath her arm, at the midnight hour. One night she caught King Henry, he was in the canteen bar. Said he, "Are you Jane Seymour, Anne Boleyn, or Catherine Parr? For how the sweet and fairy Anne, do I know who you are? With your head tucked underneath your arm."